a rough outline of what I will be talking about today. First, I will explain what our goals were during this project. And then I will explain our research method, what equipment we used, and how we designed and conducted our experiment. Finally, I will report the results that we collected and the conclusions that were drawn from these results. So, interacting with the large stereoscopic workspace is really not so straightforward. You can see me here interacting with such a large display. In fact, the one that we used was over 100 inches in diagonal. I am using a custom-made pointer and a Wiimote to control a simple 3D modeling application where you actually build basic shapes and move them around. So the display is really too large for direct manipulation. So therefore, we need some kind of indirect manipulation, like we use, like when we use a mouse or a tablet for the 2D for 2D interfaces. The question that arises here is which one of those is better. So our there were two goals in our study. The first of all, we wanted to compare two different modes of 3D interaction with a large stereoscopic display, where the physical pointer is in a volume that is separate from the display volume. And there were these two modes were absolute mode and relative mode. In absolute mode, the position of the physical pointer is exactly maps to the position of the virtual pointer inside the display volume. And this is analogous to a 2D graphics tablet. In relative mode, the motion of the physical pointer corresponds to motion of the virtual pointer inside the display volume, but however, their absolute positions do not really correspond. And this is analogous to a 2D mouse, where there is no direct correspondence between the position of the mouse and the position of the pointer inside the 2D screen. Okay, so both the statistical analysis that we performed and our participants' feedback strongly favored the absolute mode of interaction over the relative mode of interaction. And this is interesting because this is in contrast to the 2D display case where the mouse that represents the relative mode of interaction is far more prevalent than the graphics tablet, which is represents the absolute mode of interaction. Our second goal was to investigate whether head tracking had any significant effect on 3D interaction. There was no statistically significant advantage to using head tracking. However, what is also interesting is that almost all of our participants strongly preferred using head tracking in their interaction. So for the purposes of our experiment, we needed to implement a 6 degrees of freedom input device that would be used as a 3D pointer. This device was constructed out of doweling, cardboard, and duct tape. You can see it in the middle here. And we needed to track this object, and we also needed to track the observer's head in order to provide head tracking. For this purpose, we used a Vicon optical tracker system with 10 cameras. And you can see also the cup that was used to track the observer's head and the stereoscopic, Polaris glasses that were used for the viewing stereo. We also used Wiimote to provide some basic buttons for triggering functionality during our experiment. The most important of this functionality was the ability to freeze the virtual pointer inside the screen, inside the display volume, in the same way that we freeze the mouse when we pick it up from our table when we are working with it. So stereoscopic display was provided by a depth Q stereo projector, high frequency. The screen was, as I already told you, very big. It was over 100 inches in diagonal. And the stereoscopic base was about 200 centimeters deep, entirely behind the screen. You can see our screen here and the stereoscopic space behind. The observer here, notice the relative size of the display and the observer. also the manipulation space was the same physical size as the perceived volume that was behind the screen, and it was centered about 3 meters in front of the screen. So in order to compare relative and absolute interaction, as well as the effect of head tracking on 3D interaction, we designed the four-way within subjects experiment. The four configurations of the experiment were made out of combinations between absolute versus relative and head tracking versus no head tracking. We used two experimental tasks for collecting enough quantitative and qualitative data on the user's experience. The first was a pegboard task, and the second was a simple 3D modeling task. I'll tell you what this means. So the pegboard task was the first task, and it captured quantitative data about the performance of our participants in simple peg and hold assignments. So you basically had a peg, you could pick it up, and you were supposed to put it in the hole as accurately and as quickly as possible. So speed and accuracy were chosen as the best performance metrics for this experiment. And in order to gather enough data, there were 5 holes and 5 pegs that fit into the holes, giving a total of 20 speed and 20 accuracy measurements per user for all the 4 configurations of the experiment. Our second task was a simple 3D modeling task that was designed to capture qualitative data about the experience of the participants. And these data were collected by using a questionnaire that was filled out by the participants after completing the task. The task required the participant to draw a simple table out of axis-aligned boxes using a simple 3D modeling interface. 10 participants were recruited for the user study. Each of them were first asked to perform the pegboard task as fast and as accurately as possible. And a random ordering of the 4 experiment configurations was used in order to alleviate any learning effects. After running the pegboard task in all 4 configurations, the participant was shown the controls for the 3D modeling task and was given about 5 minutes to interact with the modeling task. And he was then asked to build this simple table in all of the 4 configurations of the experiment. Finally, the participant was asked to complete the questionnaire. And during the experiment, the behavior and the reactions and any comments of the users were recorded on paper notes. So I will talk a bit about our results. First of all, I will start with the measurements that were collected from the pegboard task. A two-way ANOVA was run on all the speed and accuracy measurements that were collected to reveal any significant differences between the experiment configurations. We also ran two-tailed t-tests that were conducted in a way so that any particular differences between particular pairs of the experiment configurations would be revealed. The ANOVA table and the tables and the t-tests p-values can be found in our paper if anyone's interested. So first, starting with the speed, this is a box plot that illustrates the mean time and also maximum minimum time to complete the task in each of the 4 configurations of the experiment. If you take a look at the first and second plots and then the third and fourth, which basically compare absolute to relative interaction both with head tracking and without head tracking, you will see that the mean completion time for absolute interaction is significantly less than the mean completion time for relative interaction. And therefore, we can say that absolute interaction is indeed significantly faster than relative interaction. And on the other hand, if you notice number plots, the first plot and the third plot, and then the second and fourth plot, which basically compare head tracking with no head tracking, both with absolute and relative modes, you will see that there is no significant difference in the mean times. Therefore, we can say that hair tracking does not have an effect on the speed of the participants. Now, moving on to accuracy. This box plot illustrates the lack of differences between the mean accuracy for all the four different configurations of the experiment. Therefore, we can see that all configurations had a mean accuracy between 6 and 7 centimeters, and none of the values was significantly different than the others. Therefore, we can say that accuracy was not affected by the interaction mode or by the use of head tracking. This plot over here illustrates the lack of correlation between speed and accuracy measurements across all of the users for all the four configurations of the experiment. So on the x-axis, we have the time for completion, and on the y-axis, we have the accuracy. And we can see that there is a lack of correlation by looking at the trend lines of the four graphs, which are roughly horizontal. There is, however, a small trend towards better accuracy as speed decreases in the relative mode of interaction, but this is not significant because it was very minor. Also, we can see that the relative interaction has a more dispersed sample of speed measurements than absolute interaction, whose samples are highly clustered between 10 and 20 seconds. So now about the questionnaire. The questionnaire was completed after the 3D modeling task, and the first part asked participants about the ease of use, the ease of learning, and the perceived efficiency of the two interaction modes. As you can see here, there were 5-point Likert answers, and ranging from 1, which was worst, to 5, which was the best. Absolute can be seen in red, and relative in green. You can see here that the majority of the participants rated the absolute interaction technique as easier to learn than the relative interaction technique. The same goes for efficiency, because 80% of the participants rated the absolute technique to be 4 or 5 point efficient, whereas most of the participants rated the relative interaction technique to be 3 or 4. And finally, you can also see that most participants thought that absolute positioning was easier to use than relative positioning. The second part of the questionnaire consisted of 5 two-way selection questions. So 2 concerned head tracking and 3 concerned the interaction mode. When asked which mode they would prefer, which mode they found easier to use, 9 out of 10 people thought that absolute mode was easier to use, and also 8 out of 10 people would prefer using the absolute mode of interaction, although it was more active and potentially more fatiguing. And what's interesting is that this is supported by the statistical evidence, which revealed that the absolute mode of interaction was faster and just as accurate as the relative mode of interaction. So regarding the head tracking, we saw that 9 out of 10 people prefer using it, and all of the participants thought that it had helped them achieve better results, although the interesting thing is that there is no statistical evidence to support this. So in conclusion, our study indicates that absolute mode of interaction should be preferred to a relative mode of interaction for 3D interfaces because it is significantly faster, but it is also just as accurate and people prefer to use it. This is in contrast to 2D interfaces where the mouse is favored over the graphics tablet in many tasks, including much 3D modeling work. The performance of these two interaction techniques had not been investigated in previous work for 3D interaction, and so further work is needed to tease out the differences between the 2D and 3D experiences. Our study also clearly indicates that head tracking is not an essential feature for the 3D, for the 3D tasks that were attempted. And again, this contradicts previous work that suggests a significant effect of head tracking for similar tasks. Again, we need further work to confirm whether the results here generalize. And if so, a design choice will have to be made, since our study also showed that while head tracking provides no quantitative benefits, it does provide a qualitative improvement in the user's perceived experience. So thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you. Any questions?
Hi, Anton Koning, Erasmus MC Rotterdam. I have two questions. First, how exactly did you implement relative manipulation with this system?
I didn't really understand what you're saying.
How exactly did you implement the relative manipulation?
Yeah. This is a problem with short presentations because I didn't have the time to really say how we implemented that. So the relative interaction was basically implemented using the Wii mode. So instead of holding the 3D pointer and moving around, and the virtual pointer will follow you around in a one-to-one correspondence in the virtual volume, you would use a button of the Wiimote to freeze the pointer. So you could stand, for example, in one place and reach out, move the virtual pointer as far as you, the physical pointer as far as you could reach, and then freeze it, bring it, you would freeze the virtual pointer, bring the physical pointer back, and so on. So you would essentially be standing in the same place, and the virtual pointer could be used to reach the whole of the interaction space.
So there was a one-to-one correspondence between the movement and the pointer.
So basically, it's the same thing with the mouse. The mouse simply transmits its motion, its direction of motion, and some amount of motion. So when you pick it up, the virtual pointer inside the screen is frozen. We did the same thing, but because we didn't have a fourth dimension to use in order to freeze a pointer, we simply used a button.
Did you use 3 or 6 degrees of freedom for the
It was six degrees of freedom. You could move anywhere and also rotate and do stuff like that.
And the second question, you didn't find any difference between head tracking and no head tracking, which, given the fact that there is not much of an occlusion problem in this task, is not very surprising. Perhaps if you were to have a problem where there was occlusion between objects, it would matter more.
Yeah, basically there was occlusion between the objects because while you were trying to build, let's say for the second task, which captured the qualitative data, we were trying to build a 3D table. While you were trying to build the table, you were supposed to make sure that the legs were of equal height and they were aligned, and that the top of the table was placed on top of the legs without any legs poking out and stuff. And it was the same with the pegboard task, because you had some holes that were on the far end of the virtual space, and therefore you needed a sense of depth in order to be able to put the peg into the hole more accurately.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I think that one of the questions that he was trying to ask was, did you use the same control to display ratio in both of the conditions?
Yes. Oh, sorry. Maybe I didn't understand well. I thought you were saying that some objects were not, we didn't use occluded objects. That's what I understood.
Yeah, three questions.
Okay. Sorry. The aspect ratio was the same, yeah.
Because typically one of the reasons why, at least from my understanding, why people prefer in 2D interfaces a relative mode is because it allows you to increase the control to display ratio and not exceed the movement box. And if that's not an issue here, then it's also not necessarily as surprising.
Okay, yeah.
Question? Okay, I have one quick question. So you repeated, you know, the task. Maybe there, you know, there are several modes conditions. So one person did several tasks. So maybe you have observed some certain level of training effects.
So that's why we were. That's why we randomized the execution of the four configurations of to mitigate the learning effects.
Okay. Yeah. Any other question? Okay.
Thanks.
So thank you very much.